Football Inside Out by COPA90.
What is going on, everybody? I'm Heath.
I'm Monki.
And guess what, Monki?
What's up?
This podcast started as an audio-only podcast, right?
Yes.
And our friends at Visa heard the very first intro episode. We were just talking about who we are, a little bit like that. They were like, "Yeah." But guess what? They judged us not, and now we've won them over. They love the podcast, and so much so, they've decided to give us the opportunity to turn this into a video podcast for the remaining matches in the tournament. So, every match day left from now until the end of the tournament, we're going to have a video podcast going on to YouTube. Isn't that amazing?
Lucky us. But yeah. More importantly, lucky them.
Yeah, lucky them. Tell us what's on the menu for today.
So today we have Abby Wambach. She joined us in the podcast and we chatted about a lot of things, really. What's it like being on the road now you're not playing in the tournament? What's it like having your family on the road? What's it like in the camp for America? Et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. Very interesting chat. But first up, these are the five things that you need to know going into your day.
Football Inside Out by COPA90.
So, number one. After beating Italy, the Netherlands have qualified for their first ever World Cup semi-final and their first ever Olympics.
Pretty amazing. People didn't think that they were going to make it. They won the Euros and then they've struggled since. But here they are. Semifinals.
Yeah, we had Italy down, but they turned up, to be fair.
I know I keep bragging about this, but I feel ultimately closer to the Netherlands squad now that I got to meet Miedema.
Hang on a second.
I almost had her name wrong.
Hang on a second.
Well, obviously, we're not that close.
You were totally backing Italy like 5 seconds
no,
ago.
No, I was backing Italy as like a Cinderella story. However, yeah. I was... Is Cinderella story like a very...
No, we get that. We get that in the UK too.
No, it wasn't more of a local thing, but it was like...
Local,
you know, just
as in...
Like local, like to the US?
No. We are
No, what I was saying is that I was backing them for the Cinderella story, and I had them in a random drawing in our office pool.
Okay,
so I sort of had to back them.
And also that we want to be invited to her Halloween party.
That's correct.
With Evans, so... Which leads us into number two. Miedema, absolute machine. 61 goals in 80 games. The Netherlands.
That's illegal. That's definitely if you went to some of the certain small states around the United States, they would say that's illegal. They would just automatically hear that number and go, "Nope, doesn't work here. It's illegal. We are a conservative state. This is illegal."
I don't know if I've done 61 in 80 of anything.
How many have you scored most in a season?
26.
That's a lot too.
Yeah, but okay. I was
You were teeing
it
up
was
for
a low
that.
It was a low yeah, gone two.
Yeah, you know, I've had I would say the plus minus is two every season.
It was a very low league. I was getting back into football, so don't take it as anything serious. Last season I scored like 7 or 6 or something.
Wow.
So
that's still a lot.
Great.
Number three, Sweden have had 8 different goal scorers at the 2019 World Cup. It's the largest spread of goal scorers at a single World Cup, which is incredible. 8 goal scorers.
Yeah,
sharing the love. Very socialist, by the way.
Very socialist. You know?
It's not I, it's us.
Very
no, that's communism. It's not mine, it's ours.
It's ours.
Yeah.
It's the same thing.
Yeah. No, that's communism. No, it's really cool that if you don't have one particular goal scorer that's going to carry their weight, it's been good to see other people. Actually, Alex Morgan made a comment that it's nice to have the U.S. have the depth that they have now because it's not everybody looking to Abby Wambach to solve all their problems.
Yeah, Megan Rapinoe scored a lot of goals this tournament, so let's not forget about her. Anyway, number four.
Yeah, reports in the Spanish media, which the Spanish media, if you don't know, can be extremely controversial.
Spicy.
And very much a tabloid and looking for problems. But this seems to be a nice one. Spain World Cup star Jennifer Hermoso is set to join Barcelona.
Barcelona.
Sorry, you might not travel as much as me. Barcelona.
Yeah, oh, now I understand. Yeah. I didn't understand what you
Sorry, sometimes
before.
I get caught up in all these different languages and cultures, and I just speak in the, you know, like I'm speaking to a local. But
that's cool.
Yeah.
I'm excited for her.
Barcelona could be on track to win the next Champions League after just falling short.
Come on, Leon off all over this.
Yeah, I know. They went to a final.
I would like to see Barcelona...
I think you mean Barcelona.
Barcelona. put up another fight next season.
That'd be nice. And for number five, thanks to our friends at Visa, we have access to some cool assets. The player of the match, her interview was in Dutch, and I was able to pick up a few words because Dutch, German, there's some sort of crossover there. But Viv Miedema has won player of the match, obviously scored an absolute banger. It's been an honor to see her kind of play.
I mean, it's no surprise that she's won it, let's be honest.
No, but I would have built it up as, again, having spent time around her, you don't realize that she's that good. You definitely more because you're closer to the Arsenal ladies and you know what's going on there and you're paying attention or you have access more than I would from California. But mm-hmm. being around her, she was just like very normal. She had like the player of the year trophy on her table. She's hanging out, like we were playing with the ball inside of her apartment, and it's just crazy to see how good she actually is.
And now she wins this. Not podcast of the year, but close.
No.
Close. It looks very nice.
Player of the match.
Does she get her name in put on the back of it? Or no?
I don't know, but this is heavy. So it took some production effort.
God, she needs another bookend for that other trophy. That
imagine her on her way home texting her parents going, I think we need to make the cabinet a little bigger because this is another trophy.
So there it is.
Five things you need to know going into your day.
Football Inside Out by COPA90.
Wow. Another day. Wow. That's that cat that makes that sound, right?
Wow. He goes, wow. He goes, isn't the owner talking about food or something? No, he's like, yes.
Yes.
Said, yes.
Yeah. How you doing?
I'm good.
Clearly not well. Slightly we started the mad. Episode like that. Yeah.
No, but in a good way, in the best way possible.
Yeah.
Is today the last recording in Paris?
Yeah,
it is. It's the last day in the wine tunnel.
I've asked them to turn the AC off for us just to take it in one last time.
Oh, good. You know, great. Yeah, I was really hoping
that you'd say that. Just the aura of...
I love sweat.
Subterranean...
sweat.
Yeah, sweat. Yeah.
We've got some new pictures on the wall as well.
Yeah, some incredible... these are Visa athletes.
I've got Lucy Bronze staring at me from the wall quite... It's a bit of a deep stare.
Yeah, if I knew her, I would tell her not to make that kind of crunched face because you'll get lines on your forehead if you do that too much. You know,
I might have to just...
My parents used to say, if you keep making that angry face, it's going to get stuck like that.
If the wind blows. Was that a thing? Did they say that?
No, what's that?
Like, don't make that face because if the wind blows, your face will get stuck like that.
Really?
They would.
Is that like a cold thing?
They say where it's cold, where, like in England it's cold. Is that what you mean?
Yeah.
No, I don't think so. I just think it's a British thing maybe.
Like it would like freeze your face like that.
Did he used to say, if you eat carrots, you could see in the dark?
No, he would say if you eat carrots, you would have better vision.
Yeah.
So not in the dark. So like my little sister took that literally when we were young. And because you'd say if you sat too close to the TV, you'd have bad eyes. And she'd sit close to the TV eating carrots.
Clever.
Just the offset. Whatever. She literally did that when we were younger. We used to be like, why? She's like, yeah.
There was another one that people would say that if you ate the crusts on bread, it would give you curly hair. Is that a thing?
No, that sounds ridiculous.
I was
are you gonna be sad when this tournament ends?
Yeah, I'm gonna feel lost. Yeah. I'm gonna wake up every morning and not know where to go or what to do with myself. I might just FaceTime you, mate.
You're gonna have to reinvent yourself.
I do.
I'm gonna show up somewhere randomly, like for a call time that doesn't exist, and be like,
half two.
I'm here. Let's do this. Yeah,
cool. Halfway to two.
Halfway to two. Yeah, that's going to be a confusing thing. But now we know.
What about you? How are you going to feel after this? How long's left? Like a week? A week and a bit? A week?
Something like about 10 days, I would guess. Yeah. 9 days. It's, I'm not sure how I'm going to feel. You know, part of me is like, this is a lot of days in a row.
Mm.
We haven't really had any trouble like talking every day about things because there's just so much to discuss. But at the same time, I think it's actually the heat. The heat is the one thing that I'm just like, I'm ready to not be in the heat anymore.
I haven't really gone outside, to be honest. I've just been in here or like, you know, in the shade.
But my problem isn't the daytime heat. It's the sweating in my bed heat that I'm dealing with right now. And I don't have a fan.
I have all the windows open.
Yeah, last night was the first night that I survived the whole night with the window open.
And I woke
up, the sun was out, and I was like, oh, this is nice.
I found mosquito repellent, finally. It only took me like 3 weeks to find it. And I've literally doused myself in it.
Did you listen to our Soccer Girl Problems episode? Of course you didn't. You weren't in it, so you didn't listen.
I haven't listened to it yet.
They confirmed my theory. I guess not a theory. They said every 8 years, like all of the cells in your body die and new cells come back. So one of them was allergic to orange juice and eggs, and now she loves it. And she was growing up, yeah.
She's having an omelet every day.
Yeah.
A glass of OJ.
Yeah.
She was allergic to eggs. That sucks.
My oldest daughter was allergic to eggs for a while, like would get like really, really flush and red, like almost like not rashes, but like just visibly something's not okay.
Mm.
Doesn't have it anymore. And that wasn't even 8 years.
She's tiny. Yeah.
Yeah. But it was just literally like a year later, it wasn't the same anymore.
I'm allergic to Aperol
Spritz.
Yeah. Sucks.
But you're literally allergic to Aperol?
We haven't figured out whether it's the Aperol or if it's the alcohol in it. Because I'm not typically allergic to alcohol, but I get like really blotchy red face.
Yeah.
And I look, it looks like really bad. It looks like I've caught some sort of.
Does that happen to you ever with wine, certain types of wine too? Because there's certain ingredients. That's just me drinking a lot.
No, I don't. But I know a few of like my family members go a bit red sometimes, but it's just Aperol. One summer I was drinking some Aperol spritz and it got the better of me. Well, nothing happens. I just get really hot and I look like I need to be quarantined.
Well, I've got some good news for you. In 8 years from that period, might be okay again.
Yeah. Okay. I'll report back to you.
7 years from now, when we're on our 10,000th episode, you're going to have to report back on how we're doing with the old Aperol.
Oh, it's 2025. Quick math.
Yeah.
Everything's good. Yeah. No games today.
No games.
It's a bit sad.
It's very sad.
Yeah. I feel a bit weird when there's no games. Like, I don't know what to do with myself.
Yeah. It's more that the day already feels long here, but that the games are like kind of a nice little break. Like, they're like key indicators of what time of day it is, you know?
Yeah.
Like, without you knowing, like a game starts, you're like, okay. Because we're starting so much later than, at least in my life, normally, I'm very much a morning person. I've got kids. I get up at like 5:36. I like to just be up where it's like the quiet part of the day. Mm-hmm. And now I'm finding the quiet part of the day is the middle of the night. You know, people are like morning, like late night people or early morning people typically.
Yeah.
We're like, I found my peace and quiet in the mornings. And now it's like when we finish after every day,
it's in the
evening. It's the late night, like after midnight, I'm heading back to my place and it's just my kind of like silence.
Yeah, I am actually more of a morning person, but my job requires me to not be, which is weird for me.
Do you think that people are just naturally morning or late night people, or if it's an adjustment or like a preference?
Do you think
people actively know what they are?
Yeah, I don't think people know what they are when they're like younger.
Do you know who you are?
How do you feel in yourself?
Yeah.
Like when I was a teenager and stuff, like it's not like I'd like get up in the morning and be like, woo, the morning. But now I love getting up in the morning.
But think about roommates in a national team camp, right?
Yeah.
You have morning people, late night people.
You do?
Roommates.
Okay.
So some people like to get up, open those curtains, enjoy themselves, watch the sunrise or whatever it is. Like, doesn't have to be
watch
that.
The
doesn't
sunrise.
Have to be that. I love watching the sunrise. I probably didn't get up that early that often, but like.
Were you with the late night?
It's like 3:30 a.m. in Paris is the sunrise.
Yeah. Is it really that?
No, it's pretty early. It's like 5. But I was a morning person and occasionally I had roommates throughout my career that were late night people. So like I'm falling asleep watching something on my laptop. They're staying up late doing whatever. I get up early. They're still sleeping. And it used to really disrupt my day.
Yeah.
Because, I just felt like I'm treading in somebody else's space, like disturbing them. Like, you know, it's like a roommate, but in a hotel you're like, beds are next to each other.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
It's actually in each other's space. And I found that always really, really hard until the times that I was on teams where you had your own room if you wanted. And
is that an option?
It is, yeah.
Oh, right. I thought you always like buddied up.
You do in most cases, but some teams are like, I mean, think about it. Like you're talking about years, and this is the thing that I have an issue with within team dynamics. It's just like you spend most of your time or a lot of your time sleeping by yourself.
Yeah.
Or like in chosen sleeping arrangements, and then it's not really chosen for you and you're forced to give up certain comforts, which I don't see how, like I get it for like team chemistry and team bonding, but like also if you're spending all day with your team in camps,
yeah, that's
do you
true.
Really need to be sharing a room together?
Do you ever get players that are like horrendous snorers and so they get to like sleep in their own room because they just keep everyone up?
Yeah, I'm sure there's multiple snorers on every team around the world that are disturbing somebody else's sleep. Not only that, but like, I like to sleep with white noise. White noise freaks people out.
Do
sometimes.
You? Yeah. You're that guy.
Yeah.
Just
well, I actually
white
sleep
noise.
With brown noise is what it's called in the app.
What's that?
It's just a little bit deeper of a sound.
Do an impression. That just sounds like white noise to me.
No.
Deeper.
White noise is.
Ah, he knows. That's pretty good. That was
don't
impressive.
Fall asleep on. Are you sleeping? Hey, if you look me in the eyes and I do this for at least 2 minutes, you'll fall asleep.
Is it just that noise?
It's just that noise, and it's at a very low level.
I used to go out with someone who would want to fall asleep to the noise of a hairdryer.
Okay.
But,
that's interesting.
Yeah. I was
borderline
like,
fetishy, but.
Please turn it down.
Like, well, they would have the actual hairdryer.
No,
or
it's
like
an app. It'd be like an app.
Yeah.
But also Rooney has a weird one. I think it's hairdryer as well.
Really?
Yeah. He has like a weird noise. Or like Hoover, I think.
Yeah.
Maybe the Hoover. but again, uses an app.
Well, the white noise apps have a whole wide range of like things, like all kinds of different sounds.
Yeah, yeah. Like, have you ever tried any others?
Like frogs and stuff.
Frogs?
No, but
mean,
I was
like rainforest sort of vibe. Yeah, yeah.
Like I was joking with Soccer Girl Probs when they came in that like the white noise that I use in the afternoon when I'm lazy is the, like thunder and lightning one as an excuse to be like, oh, it's really, really bad weather outside. I'm just going to close the shutters and take a nap.
I'm like blackout, no noise.
Yeah?
That's my favorite.
Yeah. Do you sleep with earplugs?
Only if I'm on tour and I'm like sleeping on the road, like in a plane or at an airport. It's happened before.
I find that the times that I've played in the biggest atmospheres in stadiums, I've had the most trouble sleeping just of like, you know, like the constant buzz. Do you have the
you
same
mean
thing?
After?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Like after you play a big show and like your ears have that constant ring.
Yeah. 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 I have trouble sleeping after shows, but not too long. Like some people have real trouble. I guess it's the same as a match, right? If you play a big match, you come back, it's like this crazy atmosphere, so loud and so many people,
yeah.
And then you're just like put in a hotel room and it's like the complete opposite.
Yeah.
Do you
replay sets in your head?
Nah.
Like, do you not think like, I mean, you clearly are like a top level professional DJ, but there are times when have you ever like sort of like
made
beat match slowly or transition slowly or off a little bit and you hear it and you're like, no one else is going to hear it, but I heard it, and you think about it later or no?
No, I definitely sometimes think, oh, I definitely could have played a better set and that would annoy me a bit, but there's no, but it won't linger in my memory at all. Like a football match will linger much more because it's like, you could change a game. You could have maybe won that game. Whereas like DJ set, you can't really win it. You either do like, you're either happy with it or you're
kind
not.
Of competitor are you?
Yeah, I come on off the next DJ on. And I'm like
140-0. Yeah, 140-0 in my DJ career. Never lost one set.
One set, never lost a set.
No, I found the same thing when I do live stuff now is the same as, it's the closest thing to replicating what football was like, which is like prepare. But either way, like the red light goes on and the show's happening with or without you, which is just like in a football match. So say you mumble over your words and you like, it gets in your head like, oh man, I just kind of messed up there. It can get caught in your head just like a turnover early in a match and it just compounds and you keep playing worse, or you have to let it go and move on from that. And then the adrenaline that comes with that is like this pure vulnerability of like live in real time stream of consciousness mixed with like preparation with all these things that like, it's this culmination. So after it just replays in my head over and over again and I cannot sleep.
Yeah, I think live show, like live speaking and stuff, if I mess up, then I might think about it for a bit. When I did my first gig for Radio 1 in Ibiza, it was at this massive club called Ushuaia, which is like this outdoor space. And we had to get on the mic sort of every other song because it was live radio as well as a live show. So we just had to like get on the mic and be like, you're listening to BBC Radio 1, make some noise, right? But I'm used to hearing myself in my headphones when I'm on the radio, right? And they just gave me a mic and I can't hear how loud or how quiet I'm being.
Oh, and when you have echo in a crowd too, that it's so hard to listen to like...
Exactly, yeah.
Like a hot mic.
You have to turn the booth monitors down, otherwise the mic will ping off. So like you literally are just hearing what's going out in front of you, which is basically a big echo. And I did that a couple of times and I was like, make some noise for Radio 1, blah, 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 blah. But watching it back, I was basically screaming at everyone and it sounded like I was basically telling off about 10,000 people.
Yeah.
And I've never watched it back ever since.
Yeah.
I'm like, I can't even watch that.
Yeah, I can see that being hard, like really hard. I mean, I've played in front of 80,000, 90,000 people.
Yeah.
You put me in front of 10 where I've got to speak with a microphone in general and like my hands are like shaking. I'm like, how's everyone doing today? You know, like I hate it. I absolutely hate speaking in front of people.
You do?
Yeah.
Really?
Like just in terms of like, I've never really enjoyed like focused attention. Mm. Like, I mean, I love attention, but not like focused, not like spotlight. Spotlight's not my thing. And I get really, really nervous. I forget everything that I say and I end up like trying to make a joke and everybody goes like.
But didn't you go to like, didn't you study like drama?
Yeah, but like that was, doing like theater classes and stuff was just a good developmental tool for me to just get out of my comfort zone regularly.
Okay.
Because actors and people like that tend to have like, even if they're introverted, people in theater tend to like extrovert their nervousness. So like I'm very quiet. I like curl up in a ball and like get in the corner, whereas they push all of their nervous energy outward. So everybody's like, oh, like over the top. And that to me was a very hard thing. My sister's an actress. She's grew up around those people. And I never like had any ability to interact with them because I was just like, this is too much.
Right,
they're all too comfortable with themselves. But somebody explained to me that sort of studied the human dynamics of those types of people was like, no, it's just like their nervous energy is pushing outwards. You're just pushing it like you're holding it inward.
Okay.
But you guys are all just as insecure as each other. you guys are all screwed up. No, but like I learned from things like that, but it's still just like a repetition thing. Like when I do, if I were to do improv regularly now, it would take me a while to get back into it. And then from there, I'd be fine again as long as it's a repetition. But as soon as that stops...
Are there any players that you discovered that had like interesting other hobbies? Like, you know, you had a drama school? Or like strange ones? You know how like Czech's a drummer?
Yeah, there's a lot of people that have like their own, like there's some painters that I know, like artists.
Yeah?
There's, yeah, Breck Shea, he has a thing called, he's a former US international. He has a thing called Left Foot Studio, like really, really cool art.
That's cool.
He like painted and designed like walls of some of the Premier League players' houses and stuff, like design and things like that.
Yeah.
Really talented. Although the most common one is just music. A lot of people travel with like a ukulele, guitars, like those types of things.
Who played the ukulele?
I do, actually.
You did?
I play ukulele, yeah.
I can imagine you busting out a ukulele.
Well, I used to travel with like different things regularly.
I used to travel with a band.
Yeah. But the ukulele became the easiest thing to travel with. So everybody sort of started with a guitar and then they were like, okay. That's a lot to travel with every other weekend. And you get a ukulele. But there used to be like six or seven of us, even in the national team, that get together, jam out. And then Rock Band came out on PlayStation and we were just...
I used to love
that. We used to travel with Rock Band in the national team.
Yeah, yeah. Did you guys
There used to be guys that would take that wanted to play the drums, so they would take like athletic tape and tape it to their chest with the microphone so they could play the drums and do the singing part of Rock Band. Yeah.
Who is this player?
Benny Fielhaber.
Big up, Benny.
I had to call him out, man. Poor guy. He's actually got a podcast called the Benny
Drummer.
And Sal podcast. Yeah. But yeah, he was one that would tape it to his chest so he could sing and drum or sing and do like the other, like the guitar or something like that.
He should call his podcast One Man Band.
One Man Band.
Yeah. By Benny.
But it's got him and somebody else, so that one.
So somebody that's a veteran in the game, she came in and had a chat with us about lots of things. Tournament. Who snores?
Yeah.
Who doesn't?
Life on the road.
Life on the road. Yeah. This is actually a little cut down version of the full audio version, which you can hear on the podcast tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
But for now, here it is. This is Abby Wambach.
Football Inside Out by COPA90.
Let's talk a little bit about tournament management.
Mm.
So, you know, we're well into the tournament now, well into the knockout rounds. You as a player at this point have probably been in a hotel for a month and a half. How are you staying sane?
I don't think that that's actually possible. I think that you're just managing every hour as best as you can. So you get a few games under your belt. Nobody's 100%, not a single player on the team. I don't care if you've even not played a minute. Everybody is carrying around something, whether it be tired legs or you got kneed in the quad or you kind of rolled your ankle. And a lot of this stuff, you know, I know this sounds terrible, but you don't want to actually even acknowledge it. So oftentimes during world championships, I wouldn't even like go into the training room and tell the trainers like, hey, my calf is tight. I would just roll my calf by myself because I didn't want to let anybody know that there was any problem, right? So managing your body and managing the recovery and the regeneration of whatever it is you're going through is like the name of the game. And that's taking up so much of your day, not just actual recovery process, massages, you know, light lifting or whatever your methods are. The psychological component to recovery and resting is like super important. So getting around and walking like for 5 miles a day is never going to happen. They're not like sightseeing. They might get out for a short walk, get some fresh air, get some vitamin D with the sun. But, you know, it's more or less managing the emotion of what they're going through. And that's what's so beautiful about this game, because nobody knows how it's going to end up.
And for the US women, I'm assuming it's a lot higher detail of security in terms of like you even being able to go outside for fresh air.
Yeah. Not, you're not really allowed to do much. If you are, you got to go in groups. You got to probably now, and you know, I'm not in the team anymore, but I'm sure that you know, they've got security guards and agents that are from the state office that are walking around with them no matter what. And it's hard because, you know, you get cooped up. You get like so sick of, I mean, there's only so many TV shows you can watch. I feel like I've watched all of them. So you get good at boredom. You get good at, you know, playing video games or board games or something. You do some sort of creative thing. You know, during a few tournaments, I would bring my guitar and we'd like make songs up. And then now with social media, I think a lot of the players are excited about social media because it gives them like an outlet. It gives them something to do and it gives them a communication with their fans. So it's exciting to see. And I'm sure that the technologies of how their bodies are actually recovering are much and far, far more technologically advanced than when I was playing. So I definitely don't envy the place that they're in right now. I wouldn't even want to switch places with any of them because above all of that, you have this like overwhelming amount of stress that nobody talks about. Nobody's like, oh my God, I'm so stressed. Like, what if I play bad? Like, that's not the way that our national team operates. It's like, you go forward and like, we are going to win this game. And there's no opportunity for questions. Like, yes, like organizational stuff, but like, there's no question. We are winning this tournament and we're going to do whatever it can. So any kind of like insecurity or wonder or, oh, you know, like that's not a lot. You can't talk about it. So for me, that's the stuff that's really hard to deal with.
Do you have a sports psychologist on the road with you?
I think that they do. I don't know if they do, but I know that we have had them in the past.
Would that have been something that may have helped somebody that you guys could go speak to with no sort of, you know, it would be just you guys and nothing outside of that room would be told to any of the coaches or anything like that?
Yeah, we have people that have come in and taken on that. I don't know if they're actually traveling one with right now. But the thing is, you know, sports psychology is great and yet still it's not going to do anything to change the stress factor at all. Mm-hmm. Like, it's just the way that it is.
I also felt like most of the times that I had a sports psychologist around, it was hired by the coaching staff. And I was always just like, I don't want to share with this person.
Right,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, oh yeah, this person may have had a bad session because, you know, side note, this is what they're going through.
And right.
Like, I never trusted that person enough to like actually tell them.
Ethically speaking, those kind of people that are put in positions that they're taking on the sports psychology role are not supposed to be sharing. But as an athlete who is trying to gain as much control over the outcome of whether they play or how well they're playing, like, because that is such an uncontrollable factor, what you can control is like what you tell that person, because what if they said this or that, or what if they say it to another teammate, you know? So, you know, I would always tell the players to probably get somebody on the outside.
I was going to say, is that where like your family comes in? And
yeah, of course. Of course, but you know, the other thing is families are the ones that are probably the most stressed out of anybody because they just want to win for their kid, right? And defenders and goalkeepers' parents have it the worst, you know, because they're not the ones that are going to be scoring the goals. And if nobody's talking about the defenders and goalies, that means they did really good, right?
Yeah.
If you're talking about them, then something happened, which isn't in that end of the field, so that's not good. So my heart goes out to all the goalkeepers' parents and all the defenders' parents.
Football Inside Out by COPA90.
Hey, I think you have a surprise for us.
I do. So I've got it's our last day at the clubhouse.
Yes.
So some of our stuff is not heading to Lyon.
The new clubhouse.
So, our new clubhouse. So I've negotiated one of each item of COPA90's new product line.
Okay.
And you and I are going to get to go one-on-one drafting each single one. So you have to, I'll let you have first pick. So we've got about 10 items here that we've got in our COPA90 store. You and I are going to get to have 5 of these each.
Is there 10?
I don't know if there's 10. We'll find out. But we got tote bags, we got t-shirts, we got hats. So
we can do like a gladiator style sort of like death match at the end.
But for the sake of it, we're going to have some like some spur of the moments. We're going to do this quickly.
Yeah. Okay,
so you're going to have to take some. You're going to live with some regret. You're going to be excited about some things.
Fine.
Well, actually, there's nothing in here you're going to regret because it's all really rad. But like, you might be jealous of something that I end up with. Sorry.
Okay.
In advance. Okay.
Ready?
You can pick first. Go ahead.
I'm going to go for this long sleeve.
Oh, I knew that was happening. All right, then.
This is mine. I haven't got one of these yet.
That's the long sleeve with the cool like poster style back to it. Really cool. Because you've done that, I'm going with... Oh, Frank Kirby. Yes.
Okay.
You're not going to get that. I'm not going to wear it.
I was about to say, you're going to wear that?
What's... No, this is a competition between me and you now, you know?
Right.
And you don't get the Frank Kirby COVID-19 one. I'm taking that.
I'm going to go... Definitely picked the wrong long sleeve there. God.
Oh, that's not supposed to be in there. No, that's not supposed to be in there. One of every item.
This is another Frank Kirby t-shirt.
Are we going to let her keep it?
Yeah, that's your mistake.
That's true. So, my mistake.
Yeah.
Well, now, okay, we'll just charge you for that one because the free one is gone. I'm going to go with, this one's really cool. It's Pride. It's actually Pride here in Paris.
It is, yeah.
And I haven't gotten a Pride shirt, so I'm taking this. Wonderful little Pride COVID-90 one.
No, I've already got one, just saying.
Jeez Louise, this isn't that much of a competition anymore after all.
I'm a winner. If you're not first, you're last. I'm going to go for the straight up. Oh, it's the England one too.
Oh, wow.
COPA90 England t-shirt.
Oh, I didn't know that's what that was. That's really cool.
Yeah.
Show that right in there.
See this?
I hadn't even seen that one yet.
It's coming.
Cool. I'm going to quickly go with this one because it's a play on France. Chateau. COPA. How do you say COPA90?
COPA90.
90 in French?
Oh.
90.
That was good.
This is Chateau Copa 90. Play on like the wine industry here.
Yeah, I'm actually a bit jealous of that one.
I told you would be. It's only a matter of time.
I'm going to pick this one.
Oh, yeah. Just add to the collection.
Yeah. Another long sleeve.
That one's a double there. So, all right.
I like this colorway. It's like pink and
Now you got both. Black. Congratulations.
I've got both.
I've been super into totes. I never wore totes or used war. I've never accessorized with totes before, but I've been into them this summer. They've been actually really convenient. I found that when it started getting warm in London during the month that I was there, I was wearing a backpack every day you start sweating all the time on my back. I just thought that was just part of life. There was no other solution. Turns out there is.
That's a great sell.
And now it's the black and gold tote. So,
totes
totes.
I'm gonna get the other tote then.
Okay.
The white tote, England colors again. So I'm into that.
Fair enough. That means I'm closing it out with
the cap.
The coupe. What is it again?
Coupe.
The coupe Cachavendis.
I'm gonna go for the matching t-shirt, which is the only one left.
Oh, sweet.
I think we've done pretty well to be even Stevens.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you're a little bit jealous of what I got, but
am I?
That's okay.
No, it's not.
That's not the point, you know. Everybody wins here.
Everybody wins.
I'm actually glad. I just literally got an entire summer collection now. You've got long sleeves, so you're gonna have to wait until
a little bit of fall. Yeah. I might just wear like all of them at once. You know that episode in Friends of Joey wears all his clothes.
Yeah,
really represent.
Friends, that's a TV show, or
did you ever actually watch Friends?
I did. I waited till it was all finished. I'm very much a start from the beginning.
I thought you were going to say I waited till it wasn't cool to watch it, so it's cool.
I watched it like 25 years down the line, you know, it's like when I was super into like retro stuff.
The weird thing is apparently kids are like into getting into Friends again, like it's a bit of like a retro cool thing.
Friends, I would say, is the kind of show that has to be done like, I think you have to start from the start. There's so much character development in there. Like they go through a lot, but nothing at the same time all the way through. But it's just good to start from the beginning.
Can't wait to have a movie night, Heath. Whoa, I have a day of numbers for you. I have...
Ask me anything.
I have... How many do I have? I've got three.
No,
that's not a number. The first number is 900.
900. That would be the amount of bottles... We went through at the Clubhouse last night during France USA. I heard we completely sold out, and it sold out. They're free, but people were still upset. I was told people were upset last night
about the free beer,
about there being no more free beer left.
Spoiled.
Yeah,
is what I say.
Spoiled generation.
Must
have been a bunch of millennials.
Millennials.
Probably a few Gen Z, and they're drinking underage.
They were probably like drinking organic juice.
Yeah. Do you guys have kombucha here by chance?
Yeah, that's exactly what I was looking for.
Do you have a juice bar?
No, Lucy Bronze scored the 900th goal in World Cup history.
Wow.
And it was a great goal.
World Cups?
I don't know. Is that both World Cups or just the Women's World Cup?
Just the Women's World
Cup. Wow, that's a lot of goals.
That's a lot of goals. Love goals. Four.
Four would be... how many teams you'll find in any semifinals of any tournament around the world?
Well, that is true.
But, thank you.
The host nation has been eliminated at the quarterfinal stage each of the last four Women's World Cup tournaments. So China in 2007, Germany in 2011, Canada in 2015, and now France in 2019.
Wow. You want to know another fun fact with that real quick?
Yeah.
The US versus France was the first time that the hosts have played against the champions.
Really?
Yeah.
It was such a good game.
It was.
It was really close.
That was a passionate game too. Good quality. Good atmosphere.
Great atmosphere.
If that doesn't grow the game, then...
We're all doomed. Number 10.
Number 10 is the future left backs.
Number,
based on this World Cup.
Yeah,
I've seen two of them.
That's pretty cool.
Starting a movement.
USA have now won their last 10 matches at the Women's World Cup, equaling the longest run of wins in the tournament's history set by Norway between 95 and 99.
Yeah, that's right. They won in 95. Norway did.
You love a record, USA.
Yeah. It's what we do it for.
We need to stop you now.
Yeah.
We're going to stop you.
You like your chances?
Yeah, of course. Always. And that's it. That's actually all we have for today. Wow. That is the end of the episode. That is Football Inside Out. We'll be back tomorrow. Make sure you subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Acast, or wherever you listen to your podcast so you never miss an episode. And if you've enjoyed it, please leave us a little comment and review.
Please do. And subscribe to the newsletter. Head to COPA90.com/WC19 and click or tap on COPA90 France Daily to sign up. Are you getting the newsletters? You're not. I can tell you're not. You need to be in the know because there's some really, really cool stuff on there. And get in touch because we'd love to hear from you. Send us emails and voice notes to footballinsideout@COPA90.com and tweet us using the hashtag COPA90InsideOut. And we will see you all mañana.
Bye.
This is a We Are Great production for COPA90.